Hello friends, welcome to Smart Catalyst. Today we'll be seeing the current affairs of 22nd December 2018. The articles we'll be seeing for the prelims are these six. First one is about the year-end review of Ministry of Earth Sciences. Second article talks about the urban renaissance for rejuvenating and transforming the clean cities. This is with respect to sanitation and eliminating open defecation. Third topic is about Swachh Sarvekshan program. Fourth one is about National Urban Housing Fund, which was recently approved by the cabinet. Fifth article is about predatory pricing. And the final one talks about Niti Aayog's Sustainable Development Goals Index. The first article we'll be seeing is Year-End Review of Ministry of Earth Sciences. So this article was taken from PIB. So all the ministries, they released their year-end review talking about the implementation of various policies under the ministry in PIB. It is very important to go through the schemes of different ministries for the prelims exam. So under Ministry of Earth Sciences, her high-performing computing system was in use. So India has two such high-performing computers. One is called as Pratyush and the other is called as Mihir. So both of these high processing computing, they are used to measure the changes in the weather and the long time changes, that is the climate. So it is very important for India to have HPCs in order to have proper weather forecasting. So this weather forecasting is not just important to mitigate disasters and its effects, but it's also important for the welfare of the farmers. So we all know still about 50% of Indian population is still practicing agriculture as a primary profession, and 17% of India's GDP, it comes from agriculture and its allied sector. So providing proper weather forecasting facilities for the support of the farmers is very much important for their welfare. So by inaugurating this high performing computing facility, India is now placed at fourth position just after USA, UK and Japan in terms of weather and climate forecasting high processing computing. So the World Meteorological Organization also, they have appreciated the Ministry of Earth Sciences efforts in this area. Ministry of Earth Sciences has using these systems did a commendable job during Cyclone Sagar and Cyclone Mekunu in Arabian Sea, due to which it minimized the impact and saved millions of lives. So apart from this, one of the most important project of Ministry of Earth Sciences is SAFAR system. SAFAR stands for System of Air Quality and Weather Forecasting and Research. We all know the importance given to climate change these days, and this SAFAR system is a very important weather forecasting system in this direction. So this is a research-based management system to control air pollution, at the same time having trade-off with economic development. So only if air pollution is curtailed and kept under check, India nation's economic development can happen. So the objective of SAFAR is to increase awareness among the general public so that steps can be taken to mitigate air pollution. This step is very much essential, especially in the northwestern part of India, like Delhi, Haryana and Punjab, where stubble burning is very common. So this system records air quality, weather, climate and harmful UV radiation via press releases, even email alerts and also alerts via radio and other multimedia platforms. The second article we'll be seeing is Urban Renaissance for Rejuvenating and Transforming Indian Cities. So this article was also taken from PIB. So we all know about the Swachh Bharat Abhiyan, which was launched in the year 2014. So this aims to create an open defecation free India by 2019. This Swachh Bharat Abhiyan has urban as well as rural part. So the urban part is taken care by Ministry of Urban Affairs, whereas the rural part, it comes under the administrative control of Ministry of Drinking Water and Sanitation. Serious efforts has been created by constructing toilets as well as bringing in behavioral change. By using this methodology, the state aims to create 100% open defecation free India. Under this, many states have already been declared open defecation free, and we have to know how many states are declared open defecation free, as UPSC can ask questions from this area. As of now, 21 states and union territories have been declared open defecation free in India. So under this, 4 union territories have been declared open defecation free. They include Andaman Nicobar Island, Dadra and Nagar Haveli, Daman and Diu and Chandigarh. The states which have been coming under open defecation free status include Andhra Pradesh, Rajasthan, Chhattisgarh, Gujarat, ಹರಿಯಾಣ, ಜಾರ್ಖಂಡ್, ಮಧ್ಯಪ್ರದೇಶ್, ಮಹಾರಾಷ್ಟ್ರ, ಮಿಜೋರಾಂ, ಮಣಿಪುರ್, ಸಿಕ್ಕಿಂ, ತೆಲಂಗಾಣ, ತಮಿಳ್ನಾಡು, ಉತ್ತರಾಖಂಡ್, ಪಂಜಾಬ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಕರ್ನಾಟಕ. ಈವನ್ ಪುದುಚೇರಿ, ವಿಚ್ ಇಸ್ ಅ ಯೂನಿಯನ್ ಟೆರಿಟರಿ, ಹಸ್ ಆಲ್ಸೋ ಬೀನ್ ಡಿಕ್ಲೇರ್ಡ್ ಓಪನ್ ಡೆಫಿಕೇಷನ್ ಫ್ರೀ. ಸೊ ಅನದರ್ ಇಂಪಾರ್ಟೆಂಟ್ ಸ್ಟೆಪ್ ಟೇಕನ್ ಬೈ ದ ಅರ್ಬನ್ ಅಫೇರ್ಸ್ ಮಿನಿಸ್ಟ್ರಿ ಇನ್ ಕ್ರಿಯೇಟಿಂಗ್ ಅ ಕ್ಲೀನ್ ಇಂಡಿಯಾ ಇಸ್ ಸ್ಟಾರ್ ರೇಟಿಂಗ್ ಪ್ರೋಟೋಕಾಲ್ ಆರ್ ಗಾರ್ಬೇಜ್ ಫ್ರೀ ಸಿಟೀಸ್. So, by using this star rating protocol, the states are motivated to achieve garbage-free status. We all know garbage is one of the important social problem which even urban cities faces due to increasing urbanization and increasing congestion. So, by using this star rating system, which is a single metric rating system, it uses 12 protocols. Okay. It uses 12 parameters to achieve garbage-free city status. These parameters include from source segregation to scientific waste processing. The parameters also deal with plastic waste management and management of bulk waste. The special efforts are also directed towards door-to-door collection of waste as well as creating a citizen grievance redressal system. By using these steps, overall cleanliness and garbage-free status is aimed at. So the Urban Affairs Ministry has also created a platform called as Swachh Manch. So using this platform, various stakeholders from academia to the government officials, they meet to formulate a plan for creating clean, open, defecation free India. The Ministry of Urban Affairs, in order to promote competition between different states, it conducts a survey called as Swachh Survekshan. So this Swachh Survekshan has been an annual exercise since the year 2016, and in the year 2018, third round of the annual exercise was conducted. So initially the number of cities under this exercise was limited, but now almost all the census towns in the country are included under the ambit of Swachh Survekshan. So this Swachh Survekshan is conducted by Quality Council of India across various cities in India. There are three main methodologies or criteria used by the Quality Council of India to rank the cities. First one is based on the documentation collected from the municipalities. These include solid waste management and door-to-door collection, processing and disposal of waste. Second is based on citizen feedback. And third is based on independent observation. This documentation, it occupies 45% of total weightage, followed by citizen feedback, which gets 30% of the weightage, and independent observation gets 25% of the weightage. So in the recently conducted last round in the year 2018, Indore, Bhopal and Chandigarh emerged as top three cleanest cities in our country. This infographic shows the waste processing facilities in India. So according to Ministry of Urban Affairs, almost 46% of the total waste generated in the year 2018 was processed. So UPSC also asks questions with respect to statements. So these two statements were directly picked up from Ministry of Urban Affairs. So it says Kerala is leading the way in decentralized waste management, as most of the cities in the state of Kerala are installed with pipe compost and biogas plants at every household level. So another statement is with respect to state of Goa. So Goa is very efficient in waste management. So the city claims 100% door-to-door waste collection, and most of the residential units in the states, they have a composting units and kitchen gardens in order to utilize the waste and translate waste into useful products. The next article we'll be seeing is Cabinet approves creation of National Urban Housing Fund. This was also taken from the PIB. So recently Cabinet has approved creating a fund. This fund is called as National Urban Housing Fund with a corpus of 60,000 crore. This fund will be created as an autonomous body registered under Societies Act of 1860. And the overall management of this fund will come under Ministry of Housing and Urban Affairs. Here you have to know that one of important aims of Government of India is creating housing for all by 2022. And this is to be achieved by using two components. One component is for rural area and another component is for urban area. So this urban area component is carried out by Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana under Ministry of Housing and Urban Affairs. So this scheme, it aims to provide interest subsidy of 6.5%, and the beneficiaries not just include below poverty line group, but it also includes economically backward section who are up to income of 3 lakhs and also lower income groups who come under the annual income threshold of 3 to 6 lakhs. And another important thing is this Avas Yojana will also be converged with other schemes such as building toilets under Swachh Bharat Yojana, giving electricity connections under Saubhagya Yojana, LPG connections under Ujwala Yojana, and even Jan Dhan Abhiyan to get direct benefit transfer. So this this National Urban Housing Fund, it aims to raise required for the projects. So the flow of funds for central assistance, they come under different verticals. They are including beneficiary linked construction, affordable housing in partnership with the private players, inside to some slum development projects, and also credit linked subsidy scheme for construction of houses. Let's see about them. So the first one is inside to slum redevelopment project. It aims to develop the slums in our country which are under severe stress due to increasing urbanization. It aims to use land as an efficient resource with the private participation. Next is credit linked subsidy scheme, which provides interest subversions for economically weaker sessions as well as low income groups. And the affordable housing in partnership with the private players, it includes central assistance to the lower economic group. By using these schemes, the state aims to address the gap in urban progress smoothly. The next article we'll be seeing is Telecom Regulatory Authority of India. It moves to Supreme Court against the Telecom Tribunal's verdict on predatory pricing. So this article was taken from the newspaper Mint. So here the news is that the Telecom Regulatory Authority of India, it has moved to Supreme Court against the Telecom Tribunal's verdict. Telecom Tribunal's verdict based on significant market player. So according to the view of Telecom Regulatory Authority of India, the decision of the Telecom Tribunal is against its autonomy and it hinders a TRAI in performing its statutorily mandated functions. When the prices of a company's goods and services, they becomes very low to the level that it hinders other companies in a way that they cannot compete and thus they are forced to leave the market, then it is called as predatory pricing. So from the definition, it is clear that this predatory pricing is against the market-based competition as it discourages competition. From the definition, it is clear that this predatory pricing is against free market principles. As it discourages competition and can lead to monopoly. So in this context, we can understand what is significant market player. So according to TRAI's regulation, it has defined what is significant market player. So a significant market player is any company or operator which holds a share of about at least 30% of the total market activity in the relevant market. So they consider, so this market player, they have significant impact on the services they offer to the public. Since they have significant impact on the market, their area of operation is to be regulated in order to maintain healthy competition in the market. So according to the TRAI's regulation, if the tariff is found to be predatory, an operator is liable to pay a penalty of 50 lakhs per tariff plan. And another important area which is used by TRAI to determine a significant player is significant subscriber base and total gross revenue earned by the player. Only based on these two parameters, significant market players is identified. So for the prelims, one must also know what is Telecom Regulatory Authority of India. So it is a statutory body, which means it was created by Act of Parliament. It was created in the year 1997 via Telecom Regulatory Authority of India Act. So it basically regulates the telecom services, including the fixation of prices, the revision of prices or the tariff for the telecom services offered by the different companies in India. Earlier, before establishment of the Telecom Regulatory Authority of India, this regulation and revision of tariffs was carried out by the central government. Thus, by providing these services, it aims to ensure fair and transparent policy to all the citizens of India and also creates a level playing field to promote fair competition environment. So here one must also know about the telecom policy. Of 2018. So this newly released draft telecom policy of 2018, it plans to attract investment of about 100 billion in the telecom sector by the end of 2022. By attracting investment, it also aims to create indirect employment to the citizens of our country. The policy is also focused on increasing high-speed broadband penetrations in India by using new technological innovations, including 5G technology, optical fibers at affordable rates to all the citizens of our country. The final article for the day is Niti Aayog releases Sustainable Development Goal Index. This article was taken from the newspaper Hindu. So on the lines of United Nations report on achieving sustainable development goals, Niti Aayog also releases its baseline report on sustainable development goals in India. It rates all the states in our country based on 13 parameters. The states and union territories of India, they are ranked between the ranges of 0 to 100. With a score 100 signifying that the states are on the path of achieving the target by the year of 2030. The main purpose of the index is to instill competition among various states so that they can improve across various social indicators. So thereby it promotes competitive federalism. This index, it spans across 13 out of the total 17 sustainable development goals. The goals which are excluded include goal number 12, which talks about consumption and production patterns in India. Goal 13, which talks about the ways to mitigate and combat climate change. And the sustainable development goal 14, which talks about conservation of marine resources in India. These three parameters were excluded as the state did not have relevant data available in order to rank the states, and by using this it promotes competitive and cooperative federalism, thus aiming to achieve Prime Minister's Sabka Saath and Sabka Vikas by using 5 P's, that is people, planet, prosperity, partnership and peace by 2030. So according to the ranking, the top three performers include state of Kerala, followed by Goa and then Karnataka, and the bottom three are UP, Bihar and Odisha. And most of the states, they performed very well in achieving goal number 15, which includes protecting the terrestrial ecosystems. And most of the states, they are still struggling to achieve goal number 5, which is about achieving gender equality. The Kerala, which topped the ranking, it attributed significant superior performance in achieving good health, reducing hunger, and also special efforts in achieving gender equality, especially with special focus on quality education to the girl children. State of Himachal Pradesh also made significant improvement in the sector of providing clean environment as well as sanitation, and also in preserving the ecologically important mountain ecosystem of Himalayas located in the state.